5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
When I had come down this hill, I had seen this creature cross the road. It would have ripped my locked door from my truck, extracted me from my vehicle, and there wouldn't have been a damn thing I could have done about it.
This thing, I got to notice in its eyes. Its eyes was real, real evil, real sinister. The look it was giving me.
What are you reporting?
Jesus Christ, you better... Sir? Zia!
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh.
Welcome to Sasquatch Chronicles, a place where people share their encounters. Let's start the show. Welcome to the show, everyone. Thanks for being here tonight. You know, back on the 26th, I got an email from a Brian S. who asked, what is the difference between a hominid and a hominin? And it's kind of, you know, if you're not an anthropologist or, you know, a scientist, you see these two terms and it's hard to differentiate the two. What is a hominid and what is a hominin? And the easiest way to describe it, and I'll explain here in a moment why there's a difference between the two terms. Prior to the 2000s, everything was described as a hominid. Scientists wanted to differentiate the difference between us and the animal kingdom, and so they came up with the term hominin. So when you see the term hominid with a D on the end, that includes your great apes, that includes your chimpanzees, your orangutans, that includes everything extinct and still living today, and also includes humans. So when you see the term hominid, think of anything human-like that has hands and has a human-esque about it, like a gorilla or anything. Everything gets blasted into that term hominid. When you see the term hominin with an N on the end, that has to do with us as humans. And whenever I see the term hominin and you see that N on the end, try to think about not in nature. You know, we're not, as humans, we're not so much in nature. And whenever I see the term hominin, I always think not in nature, mankind, humans. And so I know the two terms are confusing. Prior to 2000, you'll see everything as being called a hominid, including us, which is true. It's just a real broad term to describe anything human-like. But when you see hominin, that is directly related to human beings, mankind, things close to our family tree. So I hope that clarifies it. I did a blog post on the 27th, breaking down the two terms, and I hope that kind of alleviates some of the confusion. Brian S., thanks for sending me the question. I really appreciate it. I want to thank James L. for sending me the article. Did you guys see this? I posted it on the blog today, on the 28th. It's a new species of ancient man found. And these researchers were out in Ethiopia, and they came across these four jawbones. And as you notice, if you read the article, again, we're talking about a new species of ancient human found. So they refer to the jawbones and what these things were as hominins. And the jawbones date back, they say, 3.5 million years ago. And they're calling them early human species. And it's interesting, if you take a look at the jawbones, they do look very human-like. There's even a recreation of what this ancient man actually looked like in the article. But it's a very, very interesting article. I appreciate the comments. I know Dave T. actually had a great point in one of the comments. He says, just proves that the point that there's multiple species of hominins existing at the same time in the past. When they were pulling up these bones, they theorized that these different species of hominins were actually walking the earth at the same time. And so Dave T. actually brings up a really good point. One of the things that he brought up that I agree with is, you know, Bigfoot, they might be hominids. I think they're more of hominids than hominins, but I could be wrong. The point I like that he made was, it's amazing that these scientists are so eager to prove this new species from the past, but not one of them is willing to look in their own backyard of living species today. That being Bigfoot, they refuse to look at it. And he does. He brings up a really good point. You know, when they find these jawbones, or find any piece of ancient man, they're really quick to label it, jump on it, give it some sort of content when they're presenting it. And, you know, it goes back to the situation we're in today. I mean, it sounds gruesome, but we really do need a piece of one of these creatures, put it into a category, and have science recognize it today. But Dave T., great point. I know Tyler D. wanted to, wants me to look into Everything You Know Is Wrong by Lloyd Pye. And I actually have, Tyler. I've looked into Lloyd Pye. I'm actually a huge fan of Lloyd Pye. I love his work. There's some things that I disagree with, just personal opinions. I'm sure that's irrelevant, but there's a few things I disagree with him on, but I love his work. I'm a huge fan of Lloyd Pye, and I wish I could have gotten him, actually spoken to him prior to him passing away. So it's kind of a shame that he passed away, but I do love his work, and I do go back and I watch those YouTube videos that he had posted. On Sunday, I'm going to be having Randy Harrington on, and Randy has probably one of the craziest encounters I've ever heard. One of the most fascinating encounters that I've ever heard. And to give you guys kind of a cliff notes, for those of you who don't know his encounter, he had one actually come up on the back of his truck. He had set up a campsite, and he was actually sleeping in his truck. And when you hear the story, you'll understand why it makes more sense of why it would come up to the truck. But if you have questions for Randy that you want me to ask him, under the post, under the podcast, Sunday show, Close Encounter, what questions do you have? Post your questions in there, and I will ask Randy your questions. Randy's been researching this for a long time. He actually has a lot of great theories on why Sasquatch do what they do. And a lot of it's based on common sense. And him and I talked the other night for a couple hours, and he really is very, very passionate about this topic. And I just love that he studied the behavior and he's able to give some insight on the behavior. Him and I talked about a couple things, and I thought, oh, you know what? That actually makes sense, what you're talking about with their behavior. I don't know that I've ever heard that before. But if you get a chance, post your question there. I will ask it on the air, and I will give you a shout-out with the question. So I'm really looking forward to Sunday. I hope you are, too. There's a new show coming on. I posted it to the blog. Well, I don't want to say it's a new show coming on. They've done a trailer for Cold Case Cryptids, and it seems like an interesting show. I hope a network picks it up. It looks like a fascinating show. Here's a clip from the show.
Are encounters between humans and monsters buried in old newspaper archives around the country? Our team has uncovered hundreds of historic tales describing encounters with mysterious biological creatures. Could our ancestors have known more about strange creatures than we have been led to believe? Join Cold Case Cryptid investigators Rob, Melissa, Max, and Jeff as they travel back in time to find the truth about these unsolved monster mysteries.
Today, we are in Meadville, Mississippi, investigating an article from 1868 where former slaves described an 8-foot-tall hairy creature lurking in the nearby woods.